Hey, everybody, we're back. It's the top of the hour, and we're going to head on over to the Connecticut Trolley Museum. Their website is www.ct-trolley.org, and we've got a little video for you to see. But before we go there, I wanted to just relay a story for those of you that are listening from the Connecticut Trolley Museum. You would never have known this, but probably back when you were first putting in that reverse loop of track, I'm trying to think, that was probably 79, 80. I cut down all the trees back when I was in Maine in the summer. I was a logger, pulpwood guy, and I cut down some huge trees. All I had to do was drop them and you guys were gonna take it from there. But I worked pretty much all of a day, and around 3 o'clock when I quit, I got to ride the one of your trolleys for the rest of the day for free. Thanks, because I did it for free. But it was a lot of fun. And I don't know how many of the people know that story, but I may have told it to a couple of your guys. But anyways, with that, guys, if we want to just quick head over to the site. So we're going to go www.ct-trolley.org, and we're going to see what's happening and where they're right in East Windsor, guys. They're not all that far. Their current president, Rob, I shout out to Rob Brogel, guys. Rob, good to see you if you're listening. And with that, we've had a video put together, by Gina. And so let's roll that videotape right now. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Gina Maria Allenberti. I am the business manager here at the Connecticut Trolley Museum, East Windsor, Connecticut. We hope you enjoy this 2020 virtual recap we put together for you.
Hi everyone, my name is William Bernal. I'm a junior motorman at the Connecticut Trolley Museum, and today we're going to be going over the quiz question from last week, which car is this car? So let's get started. This is car number 65. It was built in 1906 by the Wasson Manufacturing Company in Springfield, Massachusetts, and eventually came down to Norwich, where it worked for the Consolidated Railway Company. Once the Consolidated Railway Company became a part of the bigger Connecticut company, the car was moved from that division up to the Windsor route, where it ran many fan trips for the many people around the area. 65 has a very special meaning to all of us at the Trolley Museum, as it was actually the very first trolley car the museum ever acquired in 1941. In 1941, as everyone knows, the World War II was just starting to spool up and the scrap drives were just starting. So one of our founding members, Roger Borup, had to erect a steel fence around 65 and plead to the scrap board to make sure that 65 was not hauled off for scrap for the war effort. Over the past year, a lot of work has been done on 65 to get it ready to come back into full service, and we all thank the restoration shop crew for working so hard to get that done. And you may have actually ridden car number 65 during Winterfest or one of our other events, and we sincerely hope you like that car as much as we do and understand how much effort we put into this car. Well, thank you all for watching. I sincerely hope you enjoyed. Stay safe, everyone, and I'll see you soon. Bye, guys.
2020 was a rough year for the museum. Normally, we would open the end of March, early April, but due to the pandemic, we weren't able to open until June 20th with some major restrictions we had to follow. So our summer was pretty slow. We did try new events over the summer, like our summer music series, which proved to be very successful, and we will be doing them again in the summer of 2021.
I'm sweeping out of where I've been.
Although 2020 was a rough year for us, we did have some major accomplishments. We were able to bring back most of our operating fleet, such as car 4, 13, 26, 16, and 65. We ended 2020 pretty successfully. We had great fall events that were attended well, and our Winterfest sold out every night. None of this could have happened without our wonderful, dedicated, awesome volunteers. We are so grateful for them. We appreciate them. And if you want to volunteer, definitely give us a call or email us. It's a great family we have here.
Ho, ho, ho! Welcome to the Connecticut Trolley Museum. Have you all been good this year? The elves have been very busy working hard.
Another major accomplishment for us is we brought in a new track manager. We've had a lot of much needed maintenance done ever since we brought him in. So it's great to see all that work being done. We continue to restore company car 3001. We hope to have it done in another year or two. We do have to raise about $50,000 more in order to complete this major overhaul.
Hi, everybody. My name is Justin Chassie. I'm the Vice President and Operations Manager for the Connecticut Trolley Museum here in East Windsor. We had a car come back into service that has been on the museum's property for 11 years, our Chicago Aurora and Elgin car number 303, built by the Niles Company. This car was purchased for the museum by the Coppola family and has been in quiet storage, as we like to call it, for the past several years. The car has only come out for special occasions, but this year, due to our excellent team of volunteers helping get these cars back online, we decided to pull out 303 and do some work on it. This car is now back in service for limited runs. We're going to have this car out this spring and summer of 2021. If you'd like to come down and take a ride on a beautiful interurban car, please make your way to the Connecticut Trolley Museum. Thank you all very much, and let's have a great year this year. Enjoy the train show.
Although we did end 2020 with a loss, we feel that we did very well considering the circumstances with the pandemic. We will be opening back up in 2021 on March 27th with a full list of special events. Check out our website, www.ct-trolley.org, or check out our Facebook page to stay updated on all of our happenings. We hope you enjoyed this recap. Bye.
Betty, we're back from the Connecticut Trolley Museum, who I want to thank very much for that. And now I'd like to, just while we tee up our Eastern Seaboard Models segment with Brian, let's go to Strasburg Railroad, guys. And that's obviously in Strasburg, Pennsylvania. So let's go to a cam in Strasburg.
Oh my God, my hands are freezing now.
Bring it over to the right place. Behind Granny.
Hey everyone, we're back and we want to go visit Eastern Seaboard Models right now. And we're going to talk with Brian Busey. He actually has a video for us, so I'm not going to talk that much because he already knows what he's going to say and he won't be listening to me. So let's go look at his website first if you want. They're at esmc.com, real easy to get to. And there's all kinds of, it's a very typically well-organized website, guys, with a lot of drop downs as you scroll across. Everything you need to know about product and specialty items, dealers, shipping, videos, updates, links, what's in stock, how to email them, newsletter subscription. Oh, by the way, a lot of these sites will kind of like have a pop-up, and a pop-up is just one of those boxes that pops up right in front of what you're doing, right? And it says, hey, do you want to go on our email list? You should, because it's all about product news, all that kind of stuff. So I do it all the time because I want to see what's new out there and possibly catch a new exhibitor, that kind of thing. So whenever you see that, sign up. I know it means a lot of email into your email box, but I always use my wife's email, so who cares? So it'll allow us to see some stuff. But I use my own. But if you do want to do stuff like that, take advantage of it. Almost every place has a subscription service, you know, to sign you up. And all that means is if you're in that queue, they blast an email out to you and say, hey, there's new stuff. Check this out. Depending on how they have it. The links may be right in the email. It may invite you back to their website. It could be any kind of that that type of thing. So keep that in mind. And so as we look at the site, it's really one long front page, which I like, and they feature the latest and greatest. And they're out of New Jersey. And with that, let's roll the video. Let's go to the videotape.
I'm Brian of Eastern Seaboard Models, and welcome to the Amherst Railway Society's 2021 Virtual Railroad Hobby Show. Since 1987, Eastern Seaboard Models has offered fine-scale models based on railroad-related prototypes located primarily in Eastern North America. The company started back then by offering limited-run N-scale rolling stock on existing models, featuring schemes that never had been released in N. Our very first utilizing what is now the Atlas Trainman model. We also resurrected long dormant vintage models and decorated them in prototypical schemes for the first time, such as the 3500 PD FlexiFlow covered hopper by AHM and the 40-foot chemical tank car by River Rossi. We have released items using the models of many manufacturers such as Atlas, River Rossi, Rocco, Model Power, Delaware Valley, Red Caboose, Lifelike, Model Die Casting, Concor, and Microtrains. We graduated to tooling our own models of prototypes never released in N, starting with the Pennsylvania Class G26 Gondola. This was followed by the Pacific Car and Foundry XIH State of Maine Boxcar, the Pennsylvania Class X58 boxcar, the GSC 1958 well car, the Dispatch Shop's Class X65 boxcar, and the US Equipment Class X72 boxcar. We've also offered N-scale craftsman kits, such as the Kaiser Valley Caboose, the Pennsylvania Class G32C Gondola, and a low-side gondola based on the Atlantic Coastline and Maine Central prototypes. While our main presence has been in N-scale, we've begun to expand into other scales. Our first non-N-scale offerings were these White Tower restaurants in Z-scale. Released in numerous styles, we also offer N-scale versions. Our recent releases have seen an assortment of boxcar models hit the market. Our latest run of X58 boxcars features Penn Central, Re-Stencil Patch Out, Burlington Northern, Milwaukee Road, and the unique Conrail Sort Car. The latest X65 boxcar release includes Lehigh Valley and Conrail Re-Stencil Patch Out. Our newest X72 boxcars debuted Conrail in 3 schemes and Canadian National in 2 schemes.
All of our models are based on photographs of the actual prototypes.
Our latest charity car featured Conrail X58 Painted for Cancer Awareness. Demand for the model was far greater than we expected and it is sold out. Proceeds from the sale of this model were donated to the American Cancer Society. This was our third charity-themed car and the second focused on cancer awareness, and we will continue to offer similar items in the future. Our final 2020 offering was our holiday car featured last month and decorated by Microtrains, utilizing their photograph-like four-color process on our X72 boxcar. The model is painted metallic Arctic blue and features the wise men, Santa, and Rudolph in a frosty snowscape. It's the most ambitious holiday car we've produced to date. We also have low-profile metal wheel sets with 540-inch axles in both 33-inch and 36-inch diameter. We keep these in stock year-round, so you'll never have to worry about not being able to refit your models with quality metal wheel sets. In addition, we have ASF 70-ton ride control trucks in weathered black, freight car red, and silver. On the horizon for 2021 are the releases of new Made in America Craftsman kits. We believe our first offering will be a Pennsylvania-class G32B gondola. The kit will be similar in construction to the G32C kit, but will feature a different corrugation pattern in the side panels and ride on friction-bearing trucks. We will announce additional kits as we have them ready for release. And we will continue to offer accessory details for our N-scale rolling stock, such as our assortment of payloads for our GSC well car. Main efforts this year will be concentrated on our first HO model, the Magor Pacific Car and Foundry XIH boxcar. The model will feature over 100 standalone detail parts, including grab irons, side vents, tack boards, ladders, hatches, and door hardware. The underbody will be accurate to the prototype, with plywood sheathing rather than standard floorboards, sheathed heating pipes, and a detailed Luminator Mitchell number 14 charcoal heater. Two different roofs representing Magor 1950 construction and PC&F 1953 construction will be utilized based on the prototype. This is the PC&F configuration on this pilot model. The roof walk and brake platform will be etched metal. The model will ride on accurate ASF 50-ton A3 trucks supplied by Intermountain, and also feature KD number 148 whisker couplers and high-tech detail rubber air hoses. Tooling begins this year and the model is scheduled to debut in 2022 with the Bangor & Roostook and New Haven State of Maine as-built schemes as the first release in multiple car numbers. All of our injection molded products and fine scale wheels are available through your favorite hobby dealer. Those and all of our specialty products are available online at www.esmc.com. Please subscribe to our quarterly newsletter to stay informed on the progress of various projects by clicking the link on our website menu, and follow our Facebook page for the latest updates. Click on the specials graphic on our homepage to take advantage of special offers throughout this weekend. Thank you for your interest in our products and enjoy the rest of the show.
And now we're going to take a visit to a guy I've really gotten to know in the last year, Doug Pitney, owner of ToddArchitecturalModels.com. And that's where we're going to head in a minute. But let me tell you something. This is the guy, you heard me mention it a few times starting early this morning. This is the guy that has a Zoom meeting going all day today, all day tomorrow, just so we could simulate having people one-on-one conversations as if he were at the show, at the live in-person trade show. People walk up to the table, have one-on-one conversations. That's what he's doing. So we'll go check it out. But I want you to take a note of his website, but as well, he is an absolute professional in that he does models for mock-ups for buildings. So architectural models is how he got his start, guys. He's doing a couple of specials, et cetera, but he's actually getting into HO for the first time. He's done a lot of S, he's done a lot of O scale, a lot of building reliefs, all these different versions of all of these things you'll be able to see. I really encourage you to go talk to him about what he's doing, because I think he's doing some great stuff. When he first came to the show, one of the mock-up buildings was the old Springfield Hall of Fame building and all kinds of other things. So he does realistic buildings that were in existence at the time. Let's go check out the website. So if I head over to Todd Architectural Models, I'm going to go through my directory on the landing page, go down to Todd Architectural Models, and then click on that site, and we can see what's happening. Now, nicely done website. So what's happening here, guys, is you've got home architectural models. Just do me a favor, scroll down a little bit so you could see his architectural models. Look at that. We're talking big time. All right. This is as professional as it gets as far as displays for how buildings are going to look. You guys have all seen these. You know, you walk into the lobby of this place, and they're about ready to build this new phase, and they have a mock-up of the entire thing. This is what we're talking about doing. And look at all the new products. He's got all new products there. If you check out some discounts, et cetera, and look at this, see us at the 2021 Virtual Railway Hobby Show. I'm going to click on that and see where that takes me. All right. So if I click on that, it takes us on. And then he's got a little blow up of seeing us at the 2021 Emerson Railway Society Virtual Railway Hobby Show and blah, 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 all kinds of good stuff. And I'm looking at all of the different buildings that he has, 20% off laser cut letter sets. Ooh. Actually, I didn't notice this from before. So if I click on that, guys, over on the recent posts, if I click on that, it's going to take us to, oh, look at that. So we could actually do laser cut letters for signs for our buildings. I like this. Seriously, I have not seen that. He must have just added this, or I just didn't notice it. But it really allows, and there's a size, and you get it all different sizes. Take 20% off? Nice. I like that. All right. It looks like he's going to go to the York trade show. No, that was from before. My bad. But I like seeing what I'm seeing. So if I go all the way back up to the top, he actually does interiors of building guys, and you could get different setups for it. I know you could do like frosted glass, and I'm sure I'm saying it incorrectly, but it allows you to see all of this stuff. So again, go see Doug in his Zoom meetings. He's actually soliciting help for his HO scale model. So he's sure he's going to put it together correctly for our liking. So I'm going to go to the interior model section now, and I can see, whoa. And I see a lot of cool stuff here. So it'll allow us to see. I'm going to go to the O scale model railroad structures. I'm going to go down the manufacturing warehouses. That I know it's O scale, but don't forget he's starting to get into HO scale. But I am really interested in manufacturing warehouses and that kind of thing. Most of my layout at its widest spot is only by 2 to 2.5 feet across, guys. So I have little room for full-size buildings. And what Doug does is a lot of reliefs. And so if you click on manufacturing warehouse, trackside warehouses, that kind of thing, there are a lot of reliefs. Man, I was screaming at him, when are the HO stuff coming out? Because I could use half of this. And because most of my railroad, as I say, is heavy industrial. And I just want it to be traveling through city scenes and that kind of thing. So, and you could go shopping, and he's got a set. But if you look at about, I always remember, I told you, I always like going to the about. It tells you all about what he's doing and seeing what's going on, all that kind of stuff. So it really does allow you to see. And if I go back to that home page, right on the home page, right at the top, it mentions that the Amherst Railway Society Virtual Train Show Zoom meeting is going. And it's on from 9 to 5 today. It's on from 10 to 5 tomorrow. So he'll be around all tomorrow as well. So interesting stuff that he's doing. So make sure you tune in and check him out. Go see what he's saying. See what he has to talk about. Ask him when the HO scale stuff is out. Some are already ready to come out. And we could see from there what's happening. So it'll allow us. And look, he's got a blog. Ooh. So if I go to the blog site, you could see he's talking about the Stauffer Biscuit Company that he's working on. And you could see how different the configurations for these are as well. So it allows us to see a bunch of things. And let's go to the Contact Us page, because I usually always look to see, can I sign up? And it looks like there is. For Contact Us, it allows you to put in your name, your email, a phone, and message. He'll either email you back, or knowing Doug, he might call you back. So he's right out of Chatham, New Jersey, not that far away. He's got his email address there. So take a quick look and go talk to him, most assuredly, because you'll be able to see all kinds of stuff. So let's go just back out a little bit. And Doug, if you're listening, thanks. And we appreciate the time. And I'd love to have you on live the next time we do something, because you're really very interesting about the type of things you're doing. And I know a lot of people want to hear more about not only the HO scale stuff, but what you're also already doing. So I appreciate that time and the fact that you're with us today. And guys, one last time, go see what he's doing and call him up on his Zoom meeting. So very similar to what we're doing here, but he's got his own Zoom meeting and he looks for it. And the links are right there. So if you just go to his website and click on that link and be aware of the meeting ID and passcode, although I don't think you need one unless you're the host. But in case you do, it's right there. Click on it. And he'll bring you into the meeting, and you can have one-on-one conversations while you look at each other if you've got a webcam. So it'll allow you to do that. So thanks for that. So guys, we're headed over to Soundtracks next, but we're going to switch to a rail cam again while we set that up. So let's head to a rail cam. This time we'll make it a behind the curtain choice. Mike, take us to a webcam of your choice, and We'll see you back here, guys, in a few minutes. Hey, everybody, we're back. That was a quick break, only because we've got the TCS video that we promised queued up and ready to go. So Let's go back to that. We had some difficulties at the time, but it's ready now, and let's let it roll. TCSDCC.com.
How's it going, everybody? This is Dan Michio from Train Control Systems coming at you live, except it's not live. It's actually recorded, but you don't know that, at least not right now. And I'm joined by two of my favorite people in the world. On my left, I got Ken Patterson, host of the What's Neat show for Model Railroad Hobbyist and the What's Neat This Week video podcast. And on my right, I've got the lovely Ashley Krishone, who's joining me here today. And we're going to be talking to you all about the TCS Universal Wi-Fi Throttle. And not just the UWT 100, we're also talking about the new and exciting UWT 50. Very long anticipated product from TCS. We're happy to have finally the pre-production sample available here. And I just wanted to talk to you guys, what are your experiences? What's your impression? And why do you enjoy using your Wi-Fi throttle? Because Ken, I know you love the UWT 100 that we sent you. That's this guy right here. I know you use it every day. You tell me you run through batteries like crazy. Tell me, what are some of your favorite things about the UWT 100?
I love this throttle because of the great big LED display on it. And you're right, I do use this every day that I run trains around here. And you're right, I've been going through batteries a lot, but that's only because when I run trains, I like to just let them run really slow around my layout at about 15 or 20 miles an hour while I'm working in the shop, because my layout is designed for the run-by effect. And the nice thing about this throttle is you showed me how I could set it up where the throttle will never turn off. You have the option of turning off in 20 minutes if you want to conserve on batteries, if you're just operating your layout and you're on attention all the time, operation-wise, switching and things like that. But I like to let it run for hours and hours. And this throttle's great for that. It's got a great big LED display on it that shows when the battery's about to run out. And I love the functionality of how you plan the buttons on this. The buttons on this throttle are laid out in such a way, if you look at it, it's like the buttons on a telephone. Mathematically, they actually make sense the way they're laid out. So it's something that I'm already used to using when I'm programming locomotives or otherwise programming CVs.
That's exactly right. Yeah, so one of the things that we did, which you may find on some throttles, but not all of them, is that the number of buttons, you still have the same classical 10 buttons, 0 through 9, like you find on any railroad throttle, but some of them are organized in rows of 4. And so in that respect, it's very much not like what you might be familiar with on a telephone, where you have 3 rows of 3. So that's one of the things we took into consideration when we were designing this thing. It's a lot about ergonomics. Making not only just an ergonomic throttle that's comfortable in your hand, but making it an ergonomic user experience as well.
And I'm an experienced modeler, so I'm running all the time, and I've used so many different throttle systems that have been on the market for the last, you know, 30 years, starting with the Tech 2s and the Hoggers and all those things that we had back in the 70s and the 80s. So I know what to expect when I grab a throttle and I want to run a train. But the most amazing thing that I've seen here in the last 48 hours of you being and working with us is to watch Ashley running a train, who's not normally used to using a handheld throttle when you're running trains. And I saw that the experience was really good for you.
Yeah, it was great. Kind of representing the other side where I am really new at this and I've never used these before. So I think they both have their strengths. I really like that this one has a big screen and you can see everything really well. I like this one because it's smaller and I have tiny hands, and so that it feels really nice in my hands. I also really like the knob that they have here when you have it in yard mode, which Dan taught me all about today. And I really like that when you spin it, so if you have it in yard mode, you can feel it stop here. And so if you want it to go forward, and if you want it to go backward, you can feel it stopping there, and that's really useful. And you can also switch it, so whichever way you want it to go forward, doesn't matter. You can change it that way and set it up that way. It's really user-friendly and really easy to learn how to use. I mean, he taught me in, 10 minutes, and then I was able to do it without asking him, wait, which button is which? It's really simple and easy to use.
Yeah, that's right. One of our top recommendations or requests from our customers has been, when are you guys coming out with the throttle with a knob on it? Because not everybody loves the encoders. There's been some bad experiences from people in the industry with encoders in the past. And everybody knows their Tech 2s and their MRC power packs and stuff like that, which have a very definite 0 and a very definite 100. You got none of the volts, you got all the volts. And so this gives you the same exact sort of feel as you're going to get from your classical DC power packs in a more modern, updated, and mobile platform. Ken, I know that you're constantly working around here. You got a huge basement, and this track goes all the way around. And one of my least favorite things when I go and I'm operating with somebody's layout is I don't want to have to follow my train around, and right. I won't want to have to plug the thing in and unplug it and make sure I have the right address called up when I unplug it. And, you know, it's just a hassle. And so now this wireless system, which is compatible with basically every system that's available on the market today, in one way or another, it means that I don't have to be tethered, that I can have freedom to walk around. I can set the throttle down. I can do something else, you know. We were over there working on that one layout, and there were trains running around at that time, and I didn't have to worry about it because the throttle was with us.
And that's because you use Wi-Fi. When you're using the home Wi-Fi system, I don't have to worry about my signal dropping out on the back far corner of the layout. We've got 157 feet of main line running all the way around, so about 2.5 miles of main line. But the other test that we did was we took this throttle outside. We went all the way down to the Garden Railroad, which was a good 150 feet away from the Wi-Fi system here in the basement. And it's going through cement walls and glass. And James Regeer was still able to throttle up and make the train run on the layout here. In fact, we had it in front of the window so he could see that it was running. I was inside monitoring it. So it's amazing. The Wi-Fi system has got great reach. It's better than your standard radio system in that, again, your signal doesn't drop out when you're running your train.
That's right. So in addition to the amazing Wi-Fi functionality on the throttle, we've also got a system that we call in-throttle consisting. I gotta say, I hate consisting. I hate explaining it to people because it's so complicated. And so when we were designing our throttle system and we introduced our in-throttle consisting feature, we tried to take as much of that complexity out of this throttle as we possibly could. And so not only do you have the ability to make and break consist within the throttle itself, completely independent of your system, it's also portable. So I could go over to Ashley's house, I could go over to your house here, I could be at my house, we could all be running trains, and I could bring my consist with me, and I could bring my throttle with me, and so I don't have to set up a new consist on your system. I can just bring my throttle, bring my engines, it's portable, it's easy, and it's easy to set up, easy to break apart, and it stays in there. So the throttle has memory space where you can save your consists and your locomotives, everything becomes portable right with you, and you don't have to learn a new system or new consisting system everywhere you go.
That's amazing. That is a great feature.
Yeah. And we are currently offering pre-orders for the UWT50. We're offering two different ways to save. If you want to save $50 on the UWT50, you can pay the whole thing up front, $149.95. That's $50 off MSRP. And the other way you can save is you save a little bit up front, put $100 down, you save $25, and then the rest is due on shipment. We are expecting to ship in July of 2021.
That's an awesome deal. These aren't going to last in July. If you really want to get a hold of yours, it's best now to do that pre-order.
That's absolutely right. These things are selling like hotcakes, so if you want to make sure that you get yours, pre-order from TCS today.
That's absolutely fantastic, dude. I really appreciate the fact that you're sharing this new throttle with us. Both are great. Both are at a great deal. And Ashley, I'm telling you what, it's pretty neat.
It's good stuff, yeah.
All righty. I'd like to thank you all for joining us. And let's go run some trains.
Live in 10, live in 5, actually.
Hey, everybody, we're back. And let's head on over to soundtracks. And usually what happens here, guys, is I've been through a million meetings with George Bogatuk, and actually I just was on with George on Tuesday with Train World, and he had examples and tons of information of what's going on. We're going to play a video in a second, but I want to shout out a couple of things when we come back from that video. But let's go look at this. Let's go look at their website first. So once again, we're going to go to the landing page and then download or open up the list of exhibitors. And we're going to head over to soundtracks. And you can see their new Tsunami 2 is there. And obviously, all they do is model railroad sound systems. And guys, if you've ever talked to Nancy, who is a big part of that organization. You should, because she has been wonderful with us coming to the train show. George has been wonderful with us coming to the train show. George had a funny tagline on his name in the last meeting, but we'll leave it at that. And they do all kinds of stuff. They're right out of Colorado. And why would you choose them? It's right there. You could shop and see what's going on. They have new products. They mention the new products. And it's that purple color, guys, that's known throughout. You could see it in their shirts. You could see it in their logos when they come to the train show. But one of the years, just to give you a quick story, one of the years Nancy gave me a car. They had little commemorative cars with their logo on it, and they were purple boxcar. And it was an HON3. Now, I have an HON3 railroad on part of the Berlin Bangor in Maine, and interchanges in Waterville, Maine, and there's dual gauge trackage and blah, blah, blah. But what was happening was we were having op sessions on my train. I'd have to move that purple car to different locations, and people would try to find it, find out where it was. And it took like 3 seconds because it was so bright. But and I still have it on the layout, and I leave it that way. And it's been probably 10 years. I can't remember how long it's been. And I'm sure it was a commemorative edition of an anniversary or something. I really don't remember, but it's gotten to be a big joke at my house. And I haul that car around. I have a car card for it, and it makes drops and all that kind of stuff. So a little bit of a backstory there with soundtracks. Let's go play that video, guys. It's a short video, but I'll be back and I'll tell you about a couple more. Let's go to the videotape.
I want to show you some of those things that we do to help make sure that you get the best decoder possible. Now, one of the biggest things that sets us apart from a lot of our competition is the fact that we build here in the United States. The manufacturing floor is actually downstairs from our offices here in Durango, Colorado. Now, because of this, we're able to control the manufacturing process. We're able to make sure that we're able to respond quickly to demand, so we don't have to worry about factories closing or somebody changing or copying information. Now, one of the biggest advantages of manufacturing here is that we do test the decoder multiple times throughout the entire manufacturing process, including a hand test that our technicians go through to verify to make sure that decoder is working the first time. Nothing's more frustrating than installing a decoder, putting it on the track, and finding out that something went wrong. We do our best to make sure that you get a working decoder the first time. One of the other ways that we try to make sure that we get you the best decoder out there is when we do our audio recordings of the locomotives, we actually work with the railroads to gain access to the proper locomotive. What this does is this allows us to mic the locomotive up in specific locations to make sure that we get the proper sounds for you. Now, we are respective of the equipment, and we do realize that they're working railroads, and so we have to make sure that we're safe and respect the railroad equipment to make sure that we're not causing any damage nor causing any major inconveniences to the railroad. So when we contract with them, we actually gain permission, we gain access to the locomotive, and we actually mic the locomotive up in several locations to make sure that we get a nice mix of sounds that can bring you really the true feel of that locomotive. What we don't do is we don't walk through a field with a microphone attached to a stick and walk through along with the locomotive trying to get the proper sounds. What happens in this case is you get a lot of background sounds that have to be filtered out. You get sounds of yourself moving, other things like that that need to be filtered out. Plus, because you're not miking in a specific location, you're not getting a specific sound that you may be trying to get. And so with that, then all of that has to be filtered out, and that ruins the integrity of the sound that you're trying to capture. So now once we get the audio from the locomotive that we're working with, we come back to the sound lab and we edit the sounds to fit into the decoder. Now when we edit the sounds, what we don't do is filter out the low frequencies. We make sure to give you that full spectrum frequency so that no matter what speaker you choose, you have the ability to reproduce the sounds if your speaker is able. There are other competitors out there that pre-equalize the sound and filter out those low frequencies because they expect you to put them into a small HO model. And that's not going to give you the best sound quality for your model. We give you the 7-band equalizer along with a high pass filter in the Tsunami 2 that gives you the ability to customize the sound to match the speaker that you've chosen for your model. Now, this is just a small glimpse into the things that we do behind the scenes to help make sure that we're giving you the best decoder that we possibly can. For more information, please be sure to like and subscribe to our YouTube channel, and also be sure to check out our website at soundtracks.com for various information on our product lines, including the Tsunami 2, the Econami, a sound car, and our mobile decoder line.
Hey everybody, we're back. And before we tee up the second part of scaletrains.com, and just before that, we'll go to a cam. I need to mention there's a couple of additional videos for soundtracks that you've got to see. One of them is George Bogatuk's home layout. He does a ton of stuff for soundtracks on his home layout. And the way to get there is if you actually just Google George Bogatuk, and then or soundtracks, look for the one that says a tour of my home layout. It's probably around 37 minutes long. I watched the whole thing sometime last week. It was great. And he was really, I'm more interested in looking at his layout, but he incorporates stuff that soundtracks is doing on his home layout. So it was really cool. So, and then also watch Tsunami 2 setup and operations. That's about a 50-minute video. But if you go to youtube.com and cue that all up, you know, and just do the search for soundtracks, you'll find all of those videos. But my favorite was taking a tour of George's home layout. So guys, with that, thank you for soundtracks. And let's head over to a webcam while we get set up for scaletrains.com part two.
Justin, you're as handsome this afternoon as you were this morning.
And you happy with Scaletrains' audio levels? Woohoo, right near Shane.
Okay. Do what? They're all...